on the early hours of the morning of June the 10th, 1886, as Mount Tarawera erupted. And part of that eruption occurred where the pre-existing Lake Rotomahana was. Now, when you bring magma up underneath a lake body and the magma interacts with water, it's a tremendously explosive eruption. So there was devastating results with mud and debris and ash flung far and wide, covering many places with up to 10 meters or more of mud. So this project was all brought together to try and see if we can solve the mystery of what happened to the lake and the pink and white terraces immediately after the eruption. The focus of this particular project was the AUVs, or autonomous underwater vehicles. They can be programmed to go exactly where we want them to go, at what depth, at what part of the lake, and they're packed with sensors. Some of these sensors will determine what the topography is down there, so the lie of the land. Other sensors were looking for rocks or sediments. Other sensors tell you temperature or the acidity of the lake, and so on. So we're measuring about 9 different parameters at the same time. So on a typical day, the guys have to set up the vehicles, they need to be programmed, their mission needs to be programmed into them, they have to make sure they're ballasted correctly. And Amy, one of the scientists from Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution, she would control these vehicles.
So this is the arena's control van where we're monitoring the progress of the two AUVs that are in the water. So we're getting, through a radio connection to our computers, a status update on both vehicles every 5 to 7 minutes or so. So basically the information that's being sent from the vehicle to us displays and updates on our computer screen here. So this is a vehicle control display where it shows us the time that we received the message, the status of the actual role and position of the vehicle. And then here's our bathymetry map of Lake Rotomahana. And you can't tell, but if I undo the map overlay, you can see our track lines. And this track line is showing the vehicle we just deployed. And so you can see that it's plotting itself with these red crosshairs along where we told it to go.
She would monitor that they're doing what they're meant to be doing, that everything's fine. And the vehicle, if it didn't like anything, would send a signal back to her, and so they'd go out and rescue it. So there were two AUVs, each of which came from Woods Hole and were developed by scientists at Woods Hole. And they would have relatively separate jobs to do. One of them, for example, had a multi-beam on it, so it's looking to map the lake floor. The other one had a side-scan sonar on it to look for the differences between rocks and sediments and so on, so it can easily detect those. They each did 9 missions, and between them they covered 250 kilometres of track within the lake, which is only 6 by 3 kilometres at its longest points. So in addition to what was being done by the AUVs in the bottom of the lake, we had scientists going around the lake on the lake shore, effectively collecting all sorts of information. That included measurements of gravity, measurements of magnetism, and also collecting a number of rocks that were representative of this eruption. We also had a number of teams doing different operations on the lake surface itself. This included towing a magnetometer, measuring the magnetic field. So results from the magnetic survey show us where we have high degrees of magnetism, with the colours in red. These are rocks that are still relatively magnetised, and they've probably not seen a lot of hydrothermal fluid. By contrast, when we see the blues tell us that there's been a lot of hydrothermal fluid passed through here. And effectively, it's a window into the past. So this is telling you about the pre-1886 geothermal system, which was quite big, about 2 by 3 km. But when we plot on top of this map where the existing discharge of the hydrothermal fluids are today, there's a very large new geothermal system in the southern part of the map where it abuts against the red magnetized rocks. Sharon Walker of NOAA was one who was looking into some of the physical properties that we found within the water column.
My job in this project is to help take measurements in the water and try to relate what we find in the water to where it might come from on the lake bed. This whole screen represents what I was looking at while I was out on the lake yesterday. The blue line shows the temperature from the surface of the lake down to the lake bed, and you can see that it's warmer at the surface. At about 20 meters deep, it gets much colder, 22 degrees at the surface to about 15, 14 degrees here, and then it stays about that temperature all the way down towards the lake bed. The green line represents how cloudy the water is, and so you can see there's much more cloudiness in the surface, but then it gets a little bit more clear, but then at the bottom the cloudiness increases again. This is the range we're really interested in, because the particles, or what makes the water cloudy in this section, is probably related to what the hot springs are putting into the lake.
One of the most outstanding results from this project is the detailed bathymetry that we got from one of the AUVs. And we can recognize parts of the pre-1886 eruption lake shore in this data. So that tells us that some parts of this lake were not modified by the eruption. So an example of that is in the region of where everyone believed the pink terraces used to exist prior to the 1886 eruption. You see this distinct little arcuate-shaped spit coming out in the bathymetry. Now we can absolutely correlate that with pre-1886 eruption photographs of the lake shore. There's no doubt about that whatsoever. Once you see where the spit is, you can see just down to the south of it, here are the pink terraces. Then what we did is that we drove the side scan vehicle over this particular area, and it revealed these incredibly hard reflectors in the exact position of where the pink terraces should be. And when we look at this up close, when we zoom in here, you can see these wonderful arcuate shapes, crescent shapes of the terraces. We know they're standing 1 to 2 meters tall because there's an acoustic shadow behind them. And you can even see what appears to be round holes where the pools would have come and the hot fluid would have come up and emptied over the side of the terraces. So the last thing we did in this whole process was to lower a camera down over where we saw these hard reflectors from the side scan data. And we put the cameras right down on the lake floor, right adjacent to these structures, and we found them to be white, we found them to be very hard, and they had vertical bulbous faces, and there's no doubt in our mind that we have captured here some remnants of the pink terraces.